what do you think about Abiola the billionaire?
The billions didn't change who he was fundamentally. He was someone who was very caring, very warm, very humane, and those were qualities that remained with him until he died. But obviously, the billions changed him in terms of his lifestyle. You know, he acquired many more wives, many more children. His tastes became more and more expansive, you know. Even in the midst of the crisis, you know, he still had enough to buy planes and all kinds of things, private jets, before they became the fashion now. So Abiola the billionaire was someone who remained true to himself. He was warm, he was caring, he was generous. He liked to see, his philosophy was how to make society better for other people. Maybe having gone through extreme poverty himself, he tried to see how he could pull people up from the depths of poverty. So he did all of that.
Yes.
Okay, good. Well, I mean, it's amazing. I mean, the story of how he grew to become an entrepreneur.
Yeah.
But let me go back to politics. You were admitting here, either consciously or unconsciously, that's my perception, when I was reading, you were admitting that your dad was a bit naive. Am I correct? Was it naive? Was it, maybe he didn't understand how to play the game very well, and then eventually he became a lone ranger in a way, and the only people around him were just the civil society groups and so on.
You know, the truth of the matter is that when it comes to playing the game, he got it right in the sense that he won the election. So that, in terms of that, give him 100%. He did well. But by the time the election was cancelled, he became emotional. And when people get emotional, they can't really focus because, you know, if you want to be strategic, you can't be strategic by being emotional.
Let me read something you wrote. Okay. Sorry for being here. Something you wrote.
Okay.
In support of what you just said now. You said here that, which I found interesting, Moshood had, that was after the election had been annulled. Moshood had never been so bitter in his life. After a long pause, he concluded, "I blame myself for getting involved in this phantom transition program." He had never been so bitter in his life.
Yes,
it was really hit hard.
I would say, because MKO was not the typical politician, he wasn't a dyed-in-the-wool politician. I think he saw politics merely as a platform to achieve what his own personal objectives were, which to help people, to make society better. So in terms of being a core politician, he wasn't. And so things like that will affect him negatively and make him operate the wrong strategy whenever a crisis situation like that happens. If he was a typical politician who was used to the intrigues, the betrayals, the intricacies of normally politics, he probably will have responded better.
That aside, I think another major factor was, you said, you wrote here that he spent over $250 million.
Of course, he did. He spent even more than that, but this is even the least.
Which, when I read that, was indicative of me of why our politics is so troubling in Nigeria. If an individual could have spent that much, there's a lot of debate now in US politics, you know, about how elections are funded, you know, and all that. If he spent so much of his own personal resources like that, then you're not going to be too surprised that it was hit so hard. Apart from the fact that he lost, I mean, there was an ambition he had always had for a long time.
Yeah.
Apart from that, he had lost emotionally, he had lost politically,
financially.
He had lost a lot financially.
Yes.
No matter how wealthy he was, that's a lot of money to have spent.
It was a lot. And you know, when we talk about even being naive, I mean, if he was the same MKO he was before the elections, he would have remembered that since they are not this election, this is a military government. The only way he can take power for them is by force. Because these are people that they do coups, they hold on to the gun, and the force people. So you cannot negotiate with them to take the power back from them.
Well, another outstanding thing here is, of course, your mom, your late mom, Kudirat Abiola. I mean, it's, I read a lot about how she was killed. I mean, a lot. But reading the story here brought a different angle to it for me. The phone calls, the threats, the warnings she received, you know, and everything now culminated into that event. Was it 1996?
1996, exactly. It's only 20 years this year.
How was that for you, Benga?
It was quite...
The Kudirat story in this book.
It was quite emotional for me as well, especially as the author, you know, reminded all of us that she was only 42 years old when all of that happened. So, in essence, she was a young wife, young woman. And for that kind of woman to assume all of that burden on her shoulders, you know, fighting for her husband's mandate, taking on the military, having to coordinate all the NADECO, international contacts, etc., was a massive thing for her to undertake. And I think she did it very creditably.
Are you aware that people say that Kudirat actually pushed MKO?
Okay.
Pushed him to his death.
Okay.
Yeah. Are you aware of that?
People,
that she was, that your mother was herself a very ambitious woman. You know, who had already pictured herself as first lady. You know, and all that. And because of that, she kept pushing the man and pushing him until he got to a point of no return.
No, people will always, as I told you, anytime something doesn't work out, they will look for any, you know, it's in my mind that person that is successful in whatever they try to do is a hero. No matter what he does is wrong. Everybody knew this is a man, Chief MK Abiola, that had 250 titles all over Nigeria at the age of like 47, 48. Everybody knew that he had a presidential ambition. And that presidential ambition was the biggest and most important project in his life. So there's no woman that can push a man like that. A good woman will know what her husband wants to do. And once he has made up his mind, a good woman will support him because she knows that that's what he's going to do regardless of whatever she says or whatever she doesn't say. This is a woman that stood by the truth and she died by the truth. And that's how I look at it.
From this book, you seem to believe that the government of the day, back then, had a hand in the death of Abiola.
Well, you know that when he died, a lot of people said, let's do autopsy. And they did autopsy. And they now discovered that his heart was enlarged. And of course, there was nothing implicating the government of the day that this is what happened. But definitely, there are so many ways of killing somebody. I don't have to put a gun to your head and kill you. All I have to do is to get your medical records and know what is wrong with you. Then I'll put you in a situation that will make you just perish, you know.
Okay. So, to round up. Binga, what's your criticism here? This book, what didn't this book do for you?
There are some bits and pieces of information missing. I would perhaps, maybe you can clarify that, ascribe that to maybe, you know, family sensitivities and the fact that a lot of people were impacted by this entire issue.
Why would you give just one line or sentence to Simbiat Abiola, for example? That's for me. I mean, I was looking for Simbiat Abiola here and I saw
context,
that polygamy,
yes, the polygamous are like, you know, I came mean, it came with, I mean, it's like. I mean, that is exactly, you got it right.
So, okay, but I mean,
you know, like, you know how it is in polygamy, you know, it's like, it's good and it's also not, but at the same time, you know, she's a great woman and, you know.
Okay. A few typos here and there, you
typos,
know,
yes, I know.
Which I will not mention so that readers don't go looking for, okay. He said page 44 typo, you know, something like that.
What's the about my publisher?
I would say overall, the book, because the book does not have a fairy tale ending, you know, there's an awe factor there in the sense that, number one, MKO did not successfully reclaim his mandate. And then the fact that, you know, there were tragedies, the bereavement that he suffered. His father died, his mother died. So there's a lot of, you know, sadness and grief about the whole thing.
I didn't like part three. Part three for me was, I think it was too short. I felt that you either you were trying to, you felt you didn't have enough pages left, so you wanted to put in a lot into part three, or you had reserved part three, the rest of part three for another book. You know, I had that sense.
Possible. Okay. So
that as part three is about your story,
yes.
How you wanted to see your dad,
yes.
How you went, made attempts to go to Abuja to go,
yes.
And see him,
yes.
You know, and you were denied.
Yes. Okay, the third part, yes, it was short. And the reason why it was like that is because, you see, the first part was MKO. And when he was locked up and he became incommunicado, my mother now became the focus because you need a voice to write a story. But by the time my mother died, there was nobody else that, you know, I could use. So I now had to use myself to now conclude the book from the point that my mother died to the point that he died. So I offered myself as a bridge. But that was very difficult and very painful to write. So, and you know, I wrote the book in Arabic as well. You know, this is the Arabic version.
Oh,
of the
yes,
book.
I was coming back to that.
So, you know, I've written, the way I do my writing, I write a paragraph in Arabic, a paragraph in English, paragraph in Arabic, a paragraph in English. So if I have 44 paragraphs in both languages, that means I've already written 88 paragraphs. You see, I'm not like other writers that write in one language. I always write all my books in two languages. Like the first book I wrote, which was, this was in English, this is the Arabic. The second book, this is the English, this is the Arabic. So I always write in two languages. So I was already tired in the sense that this is a very emotional.
That's amazing. I mean,
no.
Tell me, you speak how many languages?
I speak 10 languages.
10 languages.
So I was already tired. I speak because this is a very emotional book. So, I mean, if not that the book was emotional, the book I wrote before that, this is like 364 pages. And the English version too is like almost the same. That's like, and the other ones are much longer, but this is a very emotional book.
Jamil, it's been nice having this session with you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Winga, thank you for joining us to review this book.
Thank you so much.
I hope you have enjoyed today's show. Please send us your comments, suggestions, and inquiries through any of our social media platforms displayed on your screen. I am Olakunle Kasumu. Remember, one great book can change your life. Bye-bye.